or footlongs. Subway, eat fresh.
Kids who don't eat breakfast.
The next generation of sleek, free of heavy coating silicones. EverSleek Smoothing System from L'Oreal. No heavy silicones, no harsh sulfates. Just light natural oils to smooth frizz down without weighing hair down.
Nothing beats this sleek.
L'Oreal's EverSleek.
Tonight on Primetime Nightline. Born this way? Inside the worlds of little boys who dress like little girls.
Ahula, 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 ahula.
Some who want to grow up to be women.
I want breasts one day.
From a YouTube sensation. To a cross-dressing teen who travels south of the border to pay for surgery in cash. And a message to all of them from one of the only men ever to become a woman and then a man again. Primetime Nightline, My Extraordinary Family, starts right now.
Good evening, I'm Cynthia McFadden. It caused a controversy and certainly caught our attention when the president and creative director of J. Crew was photographed in the spring catalog painting her young son's toenails pink. It led to all sorts of discussions. What should parents do if their little boy says he wants to play with dolls? What about putting on makeup or wearing a dress? And what if he says he actually wants to become a girl? We'll explore those questions over the course of the next hour. But first, a warning. Some of the themes and language in tonight's program are graphic. We begin in Seattle.
Hi-ya!
Dyson Kilo Davis is 5 years old, just like any other little boy, except that Dyson likes to wear dresses. Beach dresses, wedding dresses, disco dresses, cheerleader outfits, and especially princess dresses.
They make me feel happy, and I like them what they are.
Dyson started wearing dresses when he was barely 2 years old.
We had our first public display at daycare. Dyson ran up to me, smile as big as you can believe, in a red dress with pink heels. And I froze. I was looking around to see what the other parents were saying and how they were kind of looking at me.
Cheryl took Dyson to see a psychologist who assured her he was healthy and engaging in perfectly normal behavior. But Cheryl tried to steer him towards other clothes, other interests. But he always seemed to come back to dresses. After school one day,
he got home and said, "Look at Mommy, I'm a pretty princess." And I looked at him very, very seriously. And I said, "Boys are not princesses. Girls are." And he looked me right back, very, very strong, and said, "I am a princess boy."
Things came to a head at Halloween. Cheryl had taken Dyson and his brother, Dacoby, to the store to find costumes.
My older son, Dacoby, went for the action figure aisle, and he found a Ninja Turtle outfit and was good, very happy. Dyson saw this blue Cinderella dress, and he just begged, can you please get me a dress, Mom? And at that moment, Dacoby's tugging on my shoulder, and he says, Mom.
And she said, "What?" And then I said, "Why can't you just let him be happy?"
And that was my turning moment.
It's very pretty.
Cheryl began to embrace Dyson's love of dresses, wearing them and...
It's your dress, Mama.
Making them.
It goes like this. And
up
then
on the shoulder?
Yeah, and it goes like this, sticking under here.
Oh, it's off the shoulder.
She wrote a book about their family called My Princess Boy.
My princess boy is 4 years old. He likes pretty things.
The book was a hit. Its message about acceptance as much as gender.
If you see a princess boy, will you laugh at him? Will you call him a name? Will you play with him? Will you like him for who he is?
And suddenly, Cheryl has become an accidental activist.
Thank you for challenging what the male image is supposed to be.
Headlining an event she never imagined she'd attend, much less speak at, like Gender Odyssey, a conference on transgender issues.
Nice to meet you.
The book has been a hit with parents like Rick Phillips, a gay father.
The evening we read the book, all he could say through the whole conversation was, "Daddies, that's me."
For all the lessons she's learned about gender, Cheryl says one of the toughest is how much value adults ascribe to it.
He had on his butterfly backpack, and when we went to a gymnastics class, and there was a father there who made a comment saying, "I would never let my child wear anything like that. Right at that moment, his son went up to Dyson and said, "I love your backpack. I like butterflies." And his father grabbed him, and they walked off.
It fits me.
How we dress, how we act, it's part of what experts call gender expression.
You know, we're sitting here, we're wearing pants, we're women, it's okay. But for men, we're much more strict about it. Like, people tend to get worked up if a man shows up in a gold lamé skirt, which is one of the reasons why we get much more worked up about boys who are acting like girls. That's why we have a national crisis when a little boy is pictured with painted toenails.
Toenails? Yes, toenails. When J. Crew put out a catalog this spring showing its president, Jenna Lyons, painting her son's toenails pink, it created a firestorm. Psychiatrist and Fox News contributor Keith Abloh called it psychological sterilization and sent a message to Lyons saying, "It may be fun and games now, Jenna, but at least put some money aside for psychotherapy later." Everybody had an opinion.
Is gay. He's raising his child to be gay, I think. Yeah.
I think it's awesome. I mean, why stereotype it?
Pink toenails? I love them. on a little boy, though, I'm not so sure.
My sister painted my toenails once, and I turned out all right.
We have issues around gender in this country. We get really nutted up about it, you know.
Why?
We are very uncomfortable when we are unable to categorize.
Cheryl Killa Davis sees that, too.
They want to say, oh, he must be gay. They want to say, oh, he must be transgender. And what I'm saying is, I think at the very basic level, we're saying, accept us for who we are. Throughout life, if he is gay, if he's transgendered, whatever it is, we will accept him and love him for who he is, and we want the world to do the same.
Cheryl has also started what she calls acceptance groups, playgroups for princess boys, and all sorts of other kids where they can feel special for being different.
Don't want that tight.
7-year-old Annika, a friend of Dyson's, was one of the first members.
Some people say, you know, he wears dresses, and I say, yeah. And they say, don't you not want to be his friend? And they say, no. And they say, why are you his friend? Because he's my friend.
I think it's cool.
And Dyson? Well, Dyson seems to be perfectly happy just being a princess boy.
Our princess boy is happy because we love him for who he is.
My princess boy is your princess boy.
My princess boy is your princess boy.
Still ahead, one family must decide if they should let their little boy become a girl.
I was looking forward to raising a boy.
Primetime Nightline. My Extraordinary Family continues.
It's one thing for little boys to play dress up, but what if your son were to actually tell you he is not a boy at all, but a girl, that he is, in other words, transgender? We spent months with one family as they struggled with the wrenching decision of what to do when their 10-year-old son, Jack, said he wanted to become Jackie.
In a very small town in rural Ohio, a place long on tradition and family values,
Mommy.
A baby is born in the winter of 2001 who will change a family and a community. His name is Jack.
I was looking forward to raising a boy and throwing the ball around and going fishing, things like that.
Oh, Jack.
His parents, John and Jennifer, practice law in a firm John's father founded. They already have a daughter when Jack comes along. But early on, by the time he's only 18 months old, it's clear Jack is not a typical boy.
And I tried to get outfits for boys too, the fireman, the G.I. Joe. We had superhero costumes. Never ever wanted to put those on.
He adores the color pink. And he loves dancing in ballerina outfits and trying on frilly, sparkly tutus. At birthday parties, Jack lights up when he receives brand new Barbie dolls.
Barbie!
Tossing aside toy trucks. His sister, Sagan, is the first to ask the question.
When we were little, I said, Jackie, do you really want to be a girl?
The thought had crossed our mind that Jackie may be gay. And we were both okay with that. We didn't have any problem.
Yeah, I think Jackie was 2.5 to 3, and I started looking online just to see if I could find any information. And I found out what transgender was at that time, and I was kind of I wonder.
In elementary school, life is already tough.
Jack would get teased by other kids at school. They'd call him gay boy.
And they had since first grade.
Finally, a week after turning 10 years old, Jack, with tears in his eyes, tells his mother he has something he needs to say.
And I'm like, you know, what is it? I don't know, it's not easy. I have to tell you something. I'm like, so I'm okay, tell me what you want to say. He was like, I'm a girl and I can't do this anymore. So, and I just, you know.
What did you say?
I just say it's going to be okay.
But in truth, Jennifer and John are not so sure.
Well, it's going through my head. We need help, and I need to learn all about this.
They decide they have to take action.
Shortly after Jackie made the revelation to us, we decided we'd go for a trial run. So we let Jackie dress up in her sister's clothes.
They permit Jack to dress up at home, but they make him go to school as a boy. Each day becomes a battle.
It was a meltdown and tears, and I can't do it. I cannot put the boy clothes back on and go to school.
John and Jennifer find themselves at one of the biggest crossroads of their lives.
We thought that we might have to move to a different community just so that Jackie could transition and be a girl, and nobody would know that Jackie used to be a boy.
I think you're using a little too much of that.
Jackie, go get a Kleenex.
Yeah, go get some tissue.
Dr. Joanna Olson runs a highly regarded transgender youth clinic at Children's Hospital in Los Angeles. She believes there is only one thing parents in this position can do.
It's really important just to support your kid.
And what does support look like?
It's different for each kid. I mean, there are kids who absolutely cannot function unless they socially transition.
And Dr. Olson believes that the earlier in life kids make the social transition, the better.
We often will ask parents, you know, would you rather have a dead son than an alive daughter? These kids have a suicide rate that is astronomical.
So there's no doubt in your mind that kids, little kids even, can feel that they're in the wrong body.
Absolutely. You don't make a decision about your gender identity. It's not something you decide.
Jack's grandfather, Richard, is not convinced.
I cannot accept that a 9 or 10 year old can make decisions for himself or herself that will be life lasting. I cannot accept that.
I knew I was a boy when I was 2 years old. I think everybody knows what gender they are at a very early age.
You don't see this as one of those childish kind of whims.
No, I certainly don't see this as a choice.
I think she was born that way.
And she was born that way.
A month after Jack tells his mother he's a girl on the inside, Jennifer and John decide to allow Jack to come out publicly as transgender. He will no longer be a boy, hiding his secret life as a girl at home.
I don't feel like we ever truly had a son. We had a daughter that was unfortunately born in the wrong body.
Now, her name is Jackie.
Jackie takes a lot longer to get ready in the morning now than Jack did. That's been an adjustment,
mm-hmm.
I think, with the hair outfits and the makeup and and needing Jennifer's help with it all.
You don't use the pronoun he anymore. You've abandoned it.
That's right.
Right.
So when someone you don't know comes up and says, how many children do you have?
Now I say I have 2 daughters.
She is poised to return to the 4th grade, this time as a girl. No longer Jack, but Jackie.
This is something in 15 years of teaching that I haven't dealt with before.
Kim Bonnell is Jackie's 4th grade teacher.
Kids could be mean. You know, parents of kids could be mean. Would there be any teasing involved? Would there be any bullying situations?
Miss Bonnell talks to her 4th graders about tolerance and invites Sagan to speak to the class before Jack returns as Jackie.
Then I saw everyone crying, so I started crying. They were pretty much tears of joy because I was so happy that everyone was okay with it and there was no, like, laughing.
It does appear that over the last few months, before our cameras, Jackie blossoms socially.
She's even more spunky and more silly and more sassy than she was before. Like, she just kind of came into her own.
Guess I'd say that this one's my top wig.
Prior to the change, Jack was the odd boy who played with the girls.
I guess, like, there and there.
But now, as Jackie, she's simply one of the girls.
Shania, would the skirt go with this?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm trying to get an outfit for a pool party.
Anybody who says, no, I'm not so keen about a play date.
No.
No.
In fact, Jackie has had more play dates in the last 7 months than Jack ever had.
Miranda likes him.
Miranda and Aaron sitting in the tree.
K-I-S-S-I-N-G. Well, Jackie gets invited to birthday parties now and sleepovers and has play dates and has a social life now.
And while the little girl she knows seems to have accepted Jack's change to Jackie, Grandpa Richard remains unpersuaded.
Perhaps in the years ahead, there will be a reversal.
Jennifer's father is also deeply troubled, and it has caused a family rift.
He has voiced his concerns that, you know, if Jack chose to do this when he was 18, an adult, then that's fine, and I would accept that, but this is that Jack is too young.
But despite the disapproval of both grandfathers, Jennifer and John believe they are doing the right thing. But they're more than a little nervous this summer, 4 months into Jackie's transition, when they decide to present the new Jackie to their extended family at a reunion on Lake Erie. John and Jennifer emailed everyone in advance.
Hello.
And then...
This is Jackie. Jackie,
how are you? You remember me? You were like young.
Kind of.
Aunts, cousins,
nice to meet you.
Are all curious.
Hi.
I think some of the relatives were nervous meeting her as the girl for the first time.
I was a little bit shocked at first, and I was like, wow, I'm so impressed that we have such open-minded people in our family.
This is her grandmother.
I'm just seeing the same person dressed a little bit differently, longer hair, earrings on, and happy.
And as for her grandfather, Richard, despite his reservations, it's clear he's not giving up on his grandchild.
Bye, Grandma. Bye, Grandpa. Love you.
See you.
The weekend was a success.
Bye-bye, Daddy. I love you.
It's cold.
Bye-bye.
And Jackie's parents have made another huge decision.
I have Dr. Pepper in my bra!
This fall, they intend to put Jackie on medication that will stop her from going through male puberty. She'll be in the first generation of kids to undergo this controversial treatment, one pioneered by Dr. Olson. It is a risk. Not all kids who feel they're in the wrong body continue to feel that way through adolescence.
Do you understand that there are those, even in the medical community, who think this is a bad idea?
Every day. I talk to people every day who think it's a bad idea.
What's their best argument against your position?
I've never had anyone have a good argument against my position. So you're talking about a totally reversible effect, intervention, a reversible intervention that can be so helpful for people.
No one knows for certain what causes children to be transgender. Emerging research indicates there may be a difference in the brains of transsexuals. One thing is certain, the blockers will stop Jackie from developing into an adolescent boy, which at least now sounds good to Jackie.
I don't want hairy legs and arms. I think it's gross.
The next step will be taking female hormones. And once she's 18 and an adult,
I like bikinis the most.
Jackie will have the option of sex reassignment surgery.
I want breath one day.
I love you both!
Wait, I need kissing.
Are there still things that go through your head that make you worried, sad?
One of the biggest worries is, will Jackie find a mate, find someone to love?
I worry about that too, and I worry that she might be discriminated against in a workplace.
When you look in the mirror, who do you see?
A girl that's a person.
You see a girl that's a person?
Yeah.
Why did you decide ultimately to let us into your lives, and the hardest decision, into Jackie's life?
We don't think we should have to hide. We don't think this is a topic that should be hidden and swept away and behind a closed door. I think the lives and the quality of life for transgender people can be increased if more people just know about it.
Still ahead, we follow one desperate transgender teen across the border to go under the knife. The heartbreaking truth about how she pays for it. Primetime Nightline. My Extraordinary Family continues.
We learn in reporting this hour about a world of desperate transgender teens that is shocking and heartbreaking. Kids who turn to prostitution, black market hormones, and are even willing to risk their lives to transform their bodies. And again, a warning, this segment contains strong language.
Vanessa Rodriguez is desperate. Today, she's making a journey that is both risky and controversial. But it is a journey, she says, no one can stop her from making.
I guess I won't believe it until I'm there.
She is headed to LaGuardia Airport in New York for a flight across the border to Mexico for the surgery that will help her turn her male body into a female one. Because beneath the makeup, Vanessa is biologically a 19-year-old boy.
I don't want to go back to that awkward little boy that was shy and hid away from everybody.
Her father, Carlos, is dropping her off at the airport. He's praying she will not go through with this, but that does not stop her either.
Okay, baby. I'm ready.
Baby, okay? Call me, all right? Call me.
Vanessa's sister, Annie, says her little brother, Perry, started to change in high school.
People in his school made fun of him. They threw textbooks at him, and he had a rough time.
Life at home was tough, too.
I felt kind of bad for my parents, but, you know, it was hard for them to accept my son wants to be a girl.
Hardest for their mother.
I'm feeling that I lose my son. I get out of my bed and cry. I miss my son. I don't know where he is.
Her son spent his teenage years as Vanessa, moving through a dark and sometimes dangerous world in which transgender teens sell their bodies. It funded her drug of choice, black market hormone injections, to feminize her.
My time, it's $200 for the hour and $150 for the half. Is that okay with you?
Now she saves up for her new body by selling her old one in cheap hotel rooms.
All right, that's fine. Give me a call when you're like 20 minutes away so I can freshen up for you.
She calls herself an escort.
What really gets your attention is the pictures.
She says her clients are straight men who know she has a penis.
It was heartbreaking for me to find that out, you know, that she was doing that. I remember telling her, like, there's other ways, but she would ask me, what way? You tell me and I would do it. I had no answer for her.
I see it as a big sacrifice I have to make, but it's worth it now because I'm getting my surgery.
And so finally, it's time. Vanessa has landed in Guadalajara, Mexico's second largest city and a rising hotspot for medical tourists. Vanessa is taken straight to the hospital. As she checks in, her doctor appears, Dr. Sunny. A couple of her transgender girlfriends who know all about transitioning on a budget recommended him. His preoperative consultation is brief.
Can I take a shower in
there? I have home time, baby, because my team is getting ready for you.
The doctor is all business. There is no preoperative workup, no blood tests, no EKG.
It's okay, pay me now.
In the States, this surgery could cost upwards of $30,000. Here, it's $6,500 cash. She tells us she's not yet ready for so-called bottom surgery to remove the penis she was born with and create a vagina. But a more feminine face and a shapely body, she craves. We should warn you, Vanessa's surgery is graphic. First, her breasts. Dr. Sunny puts in 700 cc's of silicone, which Vanessa hopes will take her to around a D cup.
This is my patient type today. And this day, we have 4 surgeries more.
5 more procedures to go. He removes her Adam's apple, breaks and rebuilds her nose, and shaves down her jawline.
all in just a couple of hours.
Six surgeries in one time is no problem. Yeah, because I work very, very fast.
Doctors we spoke to here in the States said procedures like this would take more than twice as much time in the U.S. But for Vanessa, it's worth the risk. Heavily sedated, she calls home.
I did it. I'm happy, Daddy, I did it.
10 days later, her father and sister are on their way to the airport to pick up the new Vanessa.
Can't wait. And I'm pretty sure she got herself all dolled up.
And there she is.
Oh my God, I missed you. Oh, I'm sorry.
Me too, I will. I did.
On the car ride home, Vanessa explains she's getting used to her new body.
This jiggling, I never felt that before.
She got big boobs now. You know, now she can wear her clothes and not have to wear, like, you know, before she would, like, wear, like, two bras so he can look.
She may not look so very different on the outside, but the surgery seems to have given her a new confidence. Her mother has been waiting in the house she raised her little boy. Today, she's decided she will do all she can to make her new daughter feel welcome.
Welcome home, Vanessa.
Welcome home. No matter what, I love her.
Vanessa. Yay.
Because that's what she needs right now, love.
But Vanessa won't be staying home for long. She now wants a few more procedures, including brow bone surgery and lipo. That means more money. And so she has decided more sex work.
One more year.
One more year.
Maybe even, yeah.
I can hear people at home screaming, stop now while you can get out.
I'm doing what I have to do to survive or to be what I want to be. And
you could get a job at McDonald's tomorrow.
I guess.
But for now, it's back to the cheap hotel rooms, back to the dream that more surgery will make her whole.
And next, what this man has to say to transgender teens. He's had two sex change operations, going from a man to a woman and back. Still ahead, one man's incredibly unique take on living in the world as a man, as a woman, and as a man again. When Primetime Nightline, My Extraordinary Family, continues. After this, from our ABC stations. Primetime Nightline, My Extraordinary Family, continues.
He is one of the only people in the world who has ever gone from being a man to being a woman, back to being a man again. His views on transgender kids may surprise you. And a reminder, this piece contains explicit language.
Charles Kane has what's been called trans regret, a product of his own extraordinary choices. He is one of the very few people in the world to have changed his gender from a man to a woman and back again.
As far as I'm concerned, it was like somebody took me to a trip to another planet.
37 years as a man.
Yes.
And you decide.
Yes.
To become a woman.
Yes, it may have been an impulsive decision, but it sounded a good idea at the time.
At the time, he was Sam, and he tells us he'd already made millions in real estate. He'd gotten a law degree in Britain after growing up in Iraq.
You know, I was a businessman, alpha male. So I was
an alpha male, not just a male, but an alpha male.
No, an alpha male.
So you were not an effeminate man.
No, I wasn't an effeminate at all.
He lived a rather normal life as Sam, marrying and having two children.
Were you in love with her?
Yes, actually, I was very much so, yes, yes.
But all of that changed during his nasty divorce in 1996.
I lost my children. I started to just basically being curious and experimenting with my sexuality.
But Charles, lots of people are divorced and lose their children and they don't have gender reassignment surgery.
Yeah,
I mean, this is more than curiosity.
Well, yes, I mean, you know, I start having some transgendered friends, went to a few transgendered clubs. become almost like a family where you are accepted. So I thought, you know, I want to be one of them.
He says he went to a doctor and confessed that he liked dressing as a woman.
The doctor immediately said, oh, well, yes, that's normal. You are transsexual. Nothing to worry about. Let's put you on some feminization hormones and you see how you get on. So I thought, well, okay, if the doctor is telling me that, then it means I am transsexual.
So here you are in the transition to Samantha.
Yes, this one, that's early in the transition.
He had his penis removed and a vagina made, got breast implants, electrolysis to remove facial hair, had surgery to reduce his Adam's apple, and various cosmetic surgeries to feminize his face. All told, he says, he spent $100,000 to become Samantha Cain.
You were a good-looking female. I've got the pictures to prove it. I mean, here you are in the lingerie.
It was really
You're a good-looking girl here.
A good-looking girl, so...
But you didn't feel...
Yeah, well, I was a transsexual female. I wasn't a genuine, natural female.
And not being a natural woman led him to feel inadequate, he says. And so, at 44 years old, and after 7 years of living as Samantha, he found another doctor who would turn him back into a man for $50,000.
And 7 years later, at 44, you say, oops. With due respect, it sounds crazy.
Well, I mean, but people do make, decisions in their lives, or a crazy decision.
Cain believes it was the female hormones that his doctor gave him that helped push him into having the original surgery.
Do you think that you were born a transsexual human?
I don't think there is anybody really born transsexual human. Areas of the human brain get altered by female hormones. So really, you are altering the whole course of a person who otherwise a normal male.
So do you have regrets, Charles?
Yes. I pretty much don't really care about what other people think because it's my own life. But when it comes to my children, I really want them to be proud of me and to look up to me.
Since his first surgery, his children have gone for many years without speaking to him.
Well, this is really the most painful and hurtful part of my story. Yes.
These days, his story is happier. He says he's once again a heterosexual man engaged to marry a much younger woman. He is 51 and she is 28.
I didn't really suspect he'd experienced life as a woman before necessarily. I had an inkling of something, yes, definitely. I was surprised, I was shocked, but in some ways it befitted what I knew of him.
As for their sex life, I asked.
So can they actually construct a penis?
Yes, they can, yes.
Yeah. Again?
Yes, again.
But can you have an erection?
But it's erected by kind of a pump device. That's the only difference.
So that's not quite as good as the original?
Well, I think the pump device is more reliable.
May I ask, how does the pump work? I mean, it isn't something you have to carry around.
The pump is actually placed inside the testicle, so you just squeeze the testicle and then erect the penis.
Well, that's handy.
Absolutely. These, obviously, the pictures of the past.
There is nothing Charles isn't willing to talk about, even the sensitive subject of kids who are transitioning to the opposite gender. He knows his views will make him unpopular in the transgender community, but he thinks it's important for him to speak up.
I know exactly what the effect of feminizing hormone does to the mind and to the body.
He is opposed to puberty blockers, hormones, and surgery for young people.
Deeply opposed to it, and it is really almost like brainwashing somebody into sort of way of life. I had a life experience to entitle me to say this opinion.
In some ways, his life has been a human experiment. He's looked at life from both sides. His latest business venture, a dating service. Who better, he says, to understand men and women?
Up next, she's an international internet sensation. She's also the youngest person on record to undergo sex change surgery. primetime Nightline. My Extraordinary Family continues.
She is a burgeoning pop star, a YouTube sensation. And when you see her, you may be surprised that she was once a he, the youngest person in the world to transition fully from being a boy to being a girl. The description of what she went through is explicit.
Kim Petras may be the newest up-and-coming pop sensation out of Europe. There is no easy way, 'cause every way is hard. With classic blonde good looks and a wholesome appeal, 1 million MySpace hits, and thousands of devoted YouTube and Twitter fans, the 19-year-old even has a new songwriting contract from Universal.
I think it's slowing it down a bit.
She seems poised for fame.
Did you cross over? There's nobody
who decides about my... She wrote this song, The Real Me, just a couple of weeks ago, inspired by the struggles of the transgender kids who write to her. It might seem hard, but still so plain to see this is the real me. Because 3 years ago, at 16, Kim made headlines by becoming the youngest person in the world to have the penis he was born with turned into a vagina. That's right, Kim used to be Tim.
So tell me about yourself as a kid. What were you like?
I always felt like a girl, and I didn't think that I was any different than all the girls. So it was really hard for me to learn that I am different. I was being bullied. I didn't have friends. I was a freak.
But no longer. Growing up with a supportive family, home was a haven.
So from the time you were little, I mean, your parents let you wear dresses because that's what you felt comfortable in.
Yeah, definitely. They just saw who I really was, and they didn't even care of the gender.
But this is the most stylish street here in Cologne. Like, all the hipsters are shopping here.
Her sister Sina and she are now roommates in Cologne, Germany, where Kim spends her days hanging out with a large circle of friends.
Actually, she never was my brother. She was always Kim.
By age 10, Kim was already living as a girl with long hair, but still taunted and tormented at school.
I heard about this thing called puberty and wake up and be afraid that my voice would be deeper or would grow facial hair or whatever. I was just, every morning I was getting up and I was freaking out and I was just...
You were really afraid of becoming
a man. Yeah, I was definitely totally afraid. We went to doctors who all told me basically in the beginning that I was crazy.
They would say, he'll outgrow it.
Yeah, and then even some people said, oh, he's probably just gay.
She's still biologically a boy at age 11, doing all she can to look like a girl. But by then, she found a sympathetic doctor who put her on blocker drugs that suppressed her male puberty. By 13, she started estrogen.
I got the female hormones, and, you know, that's a common age where, you know, girls start puberty, and I was just developing the way a girl would develop.
But stuck in an undefined place between male and female.
So at this point, you're a girl with a penis, essentially.
Yeah, and I was feeling terribly wrong. I mean, it just didn't belong to me. It was wrong.
She was desperate for what's called bottom surgery to change her gender. Her doctors advocated for an exception to be made to the German standard, which forbids the surgery before 18.
Tonight we bring you an incredible story.
She took her campaign to the media and was granted an exception.
I had to go to tons of psychologists and, you know, beg them to do it earlier and stuff. And they all saw that 2 more years of living in the wrong body would be really difficult for me.
So as you're getting ready to have the surgery, any second thoughts?
Of course, I was a bit afraid. Many people think that after you have the surgery, you're completely happy with your life. No, it's just you feel complete. You feel at the beginning. Because that's what other girls have when they are born.
So this is a very personal question.
Yeah.
Were they able to construct a vagina from the penis?
Yeah, sure. I mean, they do that since years. It's not something really new. Of course it worked.
As for dating?
Do you have a boyfriend?
Oh, no, not at the moment. I had a boyfriend for 1 year, but no, it didn't work. sadly.
But you're looking forward to that again?
Yeah, sure, definitely. I mean, I like boys. Who doesn't like boys?
So, no regrets?
No. I have never felt better. I have always felt this way.
I just wanna dance, drink, sing, and have a good time.
Although she says she doesn't want to be known as just a transgender musician, she says she would never hide her past.
Are there misconceptions, do you think, about transgender kids?
The one misconception is that you are sick if you have it. It's like it's a disease. It's not. I mean, it couldn't be healed. There is no
imitation. Her music reflects her philosophy.
There are no limits and no boundaries. So why you want to tell me my love is a disease?
Kim was afraid, she confesses, that having the surgery, becoming a girl, might make her a joke, might make others shun her. But the opposite has occurred.
What I learned from my story is that it's really important to speak about it, because I get so many beautiful messages from people all over the world. Like, my music and my videos gave them a place where they belong. And that's really beautiful.
It might seem hard, but still so plain to see. This is the real me.
That's our program. There's already a heated discussion online. We hope you'll join in. Tell us what you think. Are parents who support their children's desire to change genders hurting them or doing the right thing? Tweet us your answer at Nightline or weigh in on our Facebook page.
Next week, families torn apart by food.
I started hurting and starving myself.
A boy who's so heavy, a controversial surgery may be his only option. And can we really be addicted to food? Tune in for My Extraordinary Family.
I'm Cynthia McFadden. Stay with ABC to watch our regular Nightline broadcast right after your late local news. Thanks for joining us.